Welcome to the YouTube channel for Bible Biker Church in Rockwood, Tennessee. I am Fred Marshall, Elder and Associate Pastor. We pray that what you're about to see is inspiring to you as it is the truth in the Word of God, as it is written. We pray that it blesses you and anyone that you share it with. If you like what you see, please click on the like button and subscribe to our channel. Also know that you can find us on Facebook under the page name Bible Biker Church. Thanks and have a blessed day. Beautiful day outside.
Yes, it is.
Makes me miss my motorcycle. 43 days since we went and picked it up. I'm sad. But you know what? There's a reason for it. Keeps me home. Mom's had a rough week, so, you know, it's good I was here. Doesn't mean we still go. But anyway, all right, that's enough of that. We got more people coming in, so filling up quick. We put more seats out yesterday. So what do you think? Is it looking better?
Yeah.
Yeah? Just bear with us as we keep doing this. All right? We have more things planned and bigger things coming. God keeps telling us. Said, be ready. You know, it says in the Bible, you know, be ready in season and out of season. But we kind of took our time in the out of season part. Our official opening was June 12th. We had 12 people. And like I said, a couple weeks ago, we had 26. We had a bunch of visitors. But there's more people here now that, you know, once they're not working, like Paul's working today, things like that. So we know that there's going to be at least 26, and it's just going to keep growing. It's going to be a little tight for a little bit. Please don't walk away from us because of that. We just cleaned out what was going to be the office. We're going to put seats in there. We're going to take this wall down probably. We may blow this back wall out. There's all kinds of things that we can do, okay? So just bear with us. But praise God, that's going to happen, right?
Amen.
There's what? Oh, yeah. I keep teasing Will, you know, where we're going to go? You know, we look at a place here, we look at a place there, nothing seems to be working out. And I keep saying, man, Scanlon Lumber Company just got sold, and it doesn't look like they're doing anything with it. That's where we should be. Look at all that covered parking for motorcycles.
Yeah, cool.
That great big building we can have a sanctuary in, and a building way down there for the kids of all ages. Right? I'm just saying, so if anybody here knows those people that might want to loan it to a startup church, you know, whatever, you know, have them call me. You know, my number's the one that's listed when you look us up on Google. Hey, by the way, I'm not going to embarrass you or anything, but how many people found us online? Right? There's several of us, you know, I shouldn't say us because I'm not in that group, but I'm going to put it together, that put this stuff together to be online. I told you last week, that, or maybe it was Thursday night, I don't know when it was, you know, I run what's called Google Ads, and it's just something that whenever you're on Google and you look something up, our information will scroll by. Yeah. I'm shaking. In 30 days, it went to 38,000 people in a 25-mile radius. As of this morning, 152 people clicked on the ad to find out about us. I've had 4 phone calls, including some people that are here today. All right? So that's just using technology for the benefit of the people to bring them to God. You know, I may not be able to do a lot of things, like we'll talk about it in a few minutes, but I just think it's amazing that we have that ability to spread the message out over the internet. The camera's rolling already this morning. You know, it's just one of those things. Praise God.
Praise God.
Let's stand up and do just that. We'll start off with a great old hymn this morning. If my phone will actually do it, there we go.
How I love that old cross where the deep
Till at last all my trophies I lay down. Paul says, everything I've gained I lost. Right? I count it all as lost. Nothing here matters. You can't take it with you. Even the guy buried on his Harley. That's just his body. It's not him anymore. So remember where your treasures lie. In heaven. Do things for him, for his glory and honor, not for your own. Now I forgot what the other two are. In the eye. But I do remember as a kid that I sang this song wrong and got in trouble. It doesn't say an exchange it someday for a clown. Anyway, so we're going on to the next.
One year in heaven was filled with his praises. One day when sin was thy has to be. Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The word came sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day they led him on Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on a tree. Self-free and anguished, spies and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. Lamb of humiliation, death on a tree. Took the nails for me, standing he loved me, dying he saved me, bearing he carried my sins far away, rising he justified freely forever, one day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day.
Somebody might say, well, you know, there's a cover missing over an outlet, which there still are. I have to order more. You know, things like that. But in this room, at least where we're sitting now, we're pretty much done. And I think it looks pretty good. That's a personal opinion. But, you know, I want you guys to feel like you're at home when you come here. Now, what God does with you when you're here is a different story. story. Okay? But you'll hear the honest truth for here while you're here. All right, so that's that. Like I said, we do have a punch list up over there. There are things that we still have to get, things we still have to do. So take a look at it if you wish. That's fine. If you can help with anything, that's great. If nothing else, just continue to pray for the ministry, because it is still under attack. Will and I can both attest to what goes on behind the scenes here. It just really wears us down. Really wears us down. But praise God, it's all about Him, not about us. Amen?
Amen.
All right, very good. Another list that will be posted this week is the ministries list. And no, I'm not going to force you to be on anything. I want you to see that there are opportunities. Because, as that last song said, the grave could not hold him. So how can this building contain him?
Amen.
So there are ministries that are coming, such as, there's a prayer team we're going to build. We have a lot of things to pray over here. We pray over every one of these prayer requests that I will come back to in a minute. We have a band starting up. If you'll notice behind me, there's stuff being set up on stage even now. And I picked up more equipment even yesterday, or day before. Praise God for that. Amen, amen. And no, I still can't play the bass. My hand just does not do that. I try. By the way, I bought a bass. So, we're good. And a left-handed guitar. Isn't that cool?
Amen.
You know, because I got the feeling there's a left-handed player that wants to play. So, anyway. There's that. There is going to be need for people to work with the children. And I say that openly and honestly. That's one of the toughest things for a church body to do, is to find people that will work with children. Okay? Now, there'll be a process that we're going to build to make sure that we don't have, you know, any one person in there by themselves at any one time, things like that. So maybe couples, it may be, you know, whatever. So just know that that's going to happen. But we have at least three children that show up here on occasions. I'm supposed to say that. Anyway, Monday, for those of us that don't work, it's another day. For those of you that do work that have that day off, that's a nice thing. For those of you that have to work Monday, thank you for what you do. But for the rest of us that don't have to work that day, we are going to have a booth at Hooray for Harriman, downtown Harriman, all day Monday. Okay? So, if you're available to come by and help, we appreciate it. There will be some of us that will be there all day. We need to be spelled every now and then so we can get up and stretch our legs, things like that. If you can, bring a chair with you, the back chair, whatever. If not, we'll have chairs there. For those of us that are going to be working, we have to be there at 7 o'clock tomorrow morning. 7 o'clock to unload. Vehicles have to be moved by 8 o'clock. The Rafer Arm Hammer starts at 9. We cannot tear down until 4. Okay, so we'll be there, you can see, 9 to 4. Some of 7 to 4, so it's going to be a long day. Then, 3 days later, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, make that 4 days later, I can't count. Anyway, especially on my hands and toes, I get to 19. Anyway, on Friday and Saturday, we have the yard sale here. And yes, we know we have things to come pick up. If you have something that you need to have picked up, please let us know so we get the trailer out. Once my vehicle gets running today, hopefully, I can come and bring some people with me to do something. Because like I said earlier, I can't do much. I lift a gallon of milk and I scream. All day yesterday, I had my granddaughter. For those of you who got to see her, she's just I shouldn't pick her up. It hurts. Sorry, I'm off on me again. Anyway, so yard sale is Friday and Saturday. That is the 7th and the 8th. Please come by. Tell people about it. We're going to have a lot of stuff. My daughter spent hours and hours cleaning out the shed. So now we have places to put stuff. We got stuff to bring, so you can bring it this week. So just letting you know it's there. It's going to happen. And there was one other thing that you told me about, and I apologize, I forgot it. Oh, that's it. It's right here, as a matter of fact. It's up here on the top of the list. So if you notice, we moved things around yesterday. Coffee's back there in the back. But also, there is a metal ammo box If you think about this from a godly perspective, what better place to put ammo to pray for people's things that need to be prayed for and for heartfelt giving to help keep this place moving forward.
That's cool.
So back there to the right of the microwave and coffee pots, there's an ammo box mounted on the little corner shelf. So please.
Spiritual ammunition.
It's spiritual ammunition, amen. Prayer cards are right above it. You do not have to fill out all the information, you know, address and stuff like that. That's just the way they come. But whatever you do put on that card, know that they are prayed for here. Just like those of you know from Thursday nights, we actually pray for whatever is said on Thursday nights. Speaking of Thursday nights, for those of you that didn't know, we have a Bible study on Thursday nights. We have a great crowd that comes, have a lot of fun, interaction, especially with a couple of people, you know, that, and it's really neat to see people of different denominations come together, because we don't care here, because I'm teaching right out of the Bible what it says, not what religion says. How about that? Does that work?
Amen.
So, if you get a chance on Thursday nights, come. If not, watch it online. Everything's on YouTube. Under Bible Bible Church, you'll see all of our ministry for sermons on Sunday, for testimonies that were given, for the Bible study on Thursday nights, music. There's a whole bunch of stuff on there. I think I've got 94 videos up there now. So just be cognizant of that. Please share that with everybody and subscribe to the channel so it will show up on more people's feeds. It doesn't help us at all, but it helps other people find us. Now, I got a request came in yesterday morning from a person that said they needed help with something. I'm shaking again. A lady needed a refrigerator. She had no place to put anything. So I sent a message out, you know, anybody got a fridge that they're willing to get rid of cheap or whatever. And nobody had anything. So as we were cleaning out, some of the storage area, I spied a little box that I remembered used to sit right about where Gene is now. It was just a little soda fridge, but big enough for a half gallon of milk and some cottage cheese. And you would have thought that I gave that lady $1 million when she got here last night. My daughter loaded it in the truck for her. You know, it's just the little things like that that can save somebody from the stress that they're in life. She told me what her job was, which is a very stressful job. The opportunity she may have of going to school and getting out of that situation into something else. And you can tell that she was really trying in life. So praise God, Bible Biker Church was able to help somebody yesterday. I'm not saying me, I'm saying the church. That's what it's all about. Amen?
Amen.
Because we are Christians. Amen? And that means something, right?
Right?
So stand up and let's sing about it. One last song. How about that, people? Is that right?
Yeah.
Get excited out there. Get excited.
I once was lost, and now I have been saved. I've seen His grace, I'll always be amazed. Call on Jesus' name, and He'll change the way you think. I go to the living well and take a drink. I'm a Christian. On a steel horse I ride, and Jesus gave me new life.
Jesus
gave me new life.
That's the truth. Amen.
Amen.
Get excited in the Spirit. Yep. Don't hold it back. Let it go. Let it go. When you want to sing Jesus, you sing Jesus.
Jesus!
There you go. Father God, we thank You for being so gracious to us to send Your Son to stand in our place, Lord, to take the punishment so that we don't have to, Lord, but that we can have everlasting life with You. Father God, again, I thank You for everything You're doing to us, for us, and through us in this place. Father God, I pray for those that aren't here. Lord, I pray for those that are out there watching. Lord, I just pray that You pull on the heartstrings of those that need to hear the truth in what Your Bible says, Father God, and that's what we're here for. So in Jesus' name, I praise You for everything that's going on. And all of the church people said,
Amen!
Very good. I'm going to teach you to say no doubt before too long.
Buckle up and hold up. At our church, we love God. Make no mistake about that. At our church, we believe in God's radical, unconditional, and unwavering love for us. At our church, we believe that Jesus is God. We also affirm that you may or may not believe that Jesus is God. We're not asking you to change your belief system before you attend our church. We're simply inviting you on a journey toward Jesus. For years, churches have placed a high priority on Jesus as the get-out-of-hell-free card. At our church, we place the highest priority on Jesus as a live life to the fullest invitation. At our church, we believe every person has a dream deep inside their hearts, and that God put that dream there, not for our glory, but for His. not display a holier-than-thou attitude toward anyone. We are all broken people, but he is putting us back together. And finally, and most importantly, at our church, we believe that Jesus really lived, that he really died on the cross, and that he really rose again.
Amen!
Chosen to sit yourself in the middle of a very safe place to hear a potentially dangerous message. Welcome to our church.
Yeah. Woo.
Good morning.
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 We got a little commercial scene that we're going to watch today that has something to do with the message that we're going to preach today. So. Ready?
All right. Here comes.
Oh, whoops.
Let's have a little music in there in the middle. How about that?
Music.
Yeah, that's fine. Oops. Don't close that. Here we go. Please. Please show. Oh, it would help if we actually did this. No. This. No. This. There it is. I'm still learning this system, people. Sorry.
That's what I want to do.
Jesus walked on the water. I know that it's true.
Be of good cheer. It's on. Be not afraid. Lord, you bid me thou. Bid me come unto thee on the water. Even if you lose your focus, when you redirect that focus to Jesus, he's still going to save you. So, when we talk about all the things that call on focus today in this message, just remember, anytime you lose that focus, you can get it back. All you got to do is know where to look.
Amen.
Okay, today we're going to be reading out of Matthew chapter 6.
start off with verse 14 and 15. Now, this is not going to sound like, at the beginning of it, that it goes with a message about focus until we tie everything together on the messages that we've been having. If you've not been here for those messages and everything, it'll still be, it's all going to still make sense. Because it does to me, and I'm probably the least educated out of the bunch. But God chose me for a reason, and that's because I can talk to you. All right, we'll start off with verse 14. This is something that we talk about all the time because it is very important to understand this. It says, "For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses." Okay? How are we able to forgive somebody that's done us wrong? Some people say, "I'll never forgive that person." Some people say, "I can't forgive that person." And some people say that person doesn't deserve forgiveness. The only way you can forgive anybody for anything they've done to you is to stay focused on God. Because just like we tell everybody that comes in here, come as you are. Don't clean yourself up spiritually before you come in the doors of the church, because there's nobody perfect sitting in here. You're not going to find anybody in here that's any better than you are. The only thing that you may find when you come in, and hopefully you will, is that there are people in here that have received Jesus in their life and they're saved and they're guaranteed that eternal life in heaven, not hell. You only serve two people. If you're serving the world, you're serving the devil. If you're serving yourself, you're serving the devil. If you're serving the place you work to make more money, to have more things, you're serving the devil. If you're going to work and you're working hard and you're thanking God for everything that you have, you're serving God. So the only thing you're going to find in our ministry are people that are saved and want you to have the same gift that God's given us. Because we've all been told. We don't keep that in ourselves. We share it with everybody. And we go out as disciples and try to bring in more disciples so those disciples can bring in more disciples. If you'll notice, every Sunday we're adding more chairs. When you think that, well, we ain't going to fit in here next Sunday if more people came. Well, more people came and we fit. Guess what? There's a wall there that can come down and still have room for a children's church and more people. So what I'm telling you is, let's keep our focus on God and let Him handle the rest. Don't come in here all cleaned up thinking you have to have your life all straightened out to come in here to be around Christian people. Because if you come around true Christian people, they're going to participate with you on letting God clean you up.
Amen.
We're not going to talk about you when you go out there and say, "I don't even know why that person was in here. They deserve to be in this church. This church is for Christians." No, this church is not for Christians. This church is for people who need to be Christian.
Amen. Amen.
What I'm saying is, your relationship with God and your Christianity with God is between you and God.
Amen.
Not between the whole ministry and God. What we do is try to help you if you need that help. What my brother and sister here do, they help me. I've got all kinds of brothers and sisters in this church that I consider my family. And they help me. They tell me when I'm going off in the wrong direction. Yes, the pastor can go off in the wrong direction easier than anybody else here. Because we stand up in front of everybody and tell everybody things to do. And if the pastor stands up here and makes it about themselves, then that's not of God.
Amen.
If I felt like I deserved to be up here, then God would not have me up here, because I don't deserve this. God called me to do it. I'm doing it because God called me to do it. And the day that I feel like God put me up here because I deserve it,
is the day that I start failing you as a congregation. And I've got people that I've specifically told, keep me on track. And I believe they'll do it. And that's what I'm talking about, the help that we do. If you're out there today and you know that your pastor can and will make mistakes, but he's already got people here that he's talked to and said, keep me on my path, then God is going to help them keep you on your path too. That's our job as a minister. When we leave out of this building, we go out as disciples, but we don't go out there as people that just want to run up and tell everybody about God. We go out of here as trained disciples, knowing that we need to study the lessons that God has put in here for us.
Amen.
To be able to share it with other people. Brother Fred said that, you know, there's people out there right now trying to get rid of the Bible. They can't get rid of what's in your heart.
Amen.
If you I've read my Bible. I don't remember exactly everything that's in it. I know enough not to be challenged by somebody over who knows the most about the Bible. That's the devil's snare. That's
Amen.
A competition. And we don't compete against each other for God.
We share.
There's only one finish line for everybody here, and it doesn't matter if you're in front of me when I get there, I'm behind you when I get there, or anybody else gets there right beside of me. There's no first, second, or third place. You know, second place here is a hug from coach. First place is the trophy.
Amen.
We don't want a hug from coach, do we? Not from my coach. My coach used to kick us and everything else. I didn't want my hug from him. Me. So we focus on God. I was sitting here today thinking about things with being focused and everything. And you think, and I can relate to this somewhat because of a military background. But you know, a sniper does not use a shotgun. And if you're not familiar with a shotgun shell is plastic. And it comes with a whole bunch of little BBs in it. And it'll probably be effective for me to Brother Fred, but it'll also be effective over the whole wall behind Brother Fred. And I don't know exactly where that's going to hit. I know some might hit Brother Fred, some might hit the walls around him and everything else. But snipers use rifles. The difference between a shotgun shell and a rifle shell is a rifle has one projectile that comes out of it. And you have to be fully focused on what your aim is before you squeeze that trigger, or you're going to miss your target. So focus, as a Christian, is a must. You see what happened to Peter when he lost focus? He started sinking. There are two times in my life that I stepped off in water that I thought was only about a couple foot deep. Both times I'd done that, stepping out in that water, I was focused on what was in the water. Both times I've done that, thinking it was only a couple of feet, it was over my head. One time it was freezing cold out there. I dropped my fishing pole when I was fishing out there in Teleco. It was in March, so it was still cold. And my friend said, and I'll tell you something if you don't know much about fishing and water and everything. In the wintertime, when it's cold out, don't know why, but the water is a lot clearer than what it is in the summertime when the water's warmed up. Well, 2 feet of water out there at Teleco is actually probably about 6 foot of water. I'm not quite 6 foot tall. So when I stepped off to get that fishing pole, it was a lot deeper. I thought I was around myself in March, freezing cold out there. But bottom line is, why is it important to just stay totally focused on God? How can we just keep looking up at God and take care of the things that are around us that we need to take care of? We're not taking care of the things around us that need taken care of. God's taking care of it for us. We have our ammo box that we put back there in the back. And this is not to solicit offerings for anybody. We do that so we don't pass the offering plate in front of people here and let your neighbors see that you're putting money in and they're not financially able to do it. And what that does is make some people feel good about themselves instead of good about what they're giving God. It makes other people feel
bad that they don't have it to give, and that's not how we want to focus our church services on. Ours is done where you can do it in private. You don't have to have someone put anything in front of you and make you feel obligated, because, like I said before, your relationship with God is between you and God. But then you think about it too. Well, wait, did he say put prayer requests in that or offerings in that? Put both of them in that. Does anybody know anywhere in God's Word that it says put what you need from God and what you're giving God in two different baskets? Because what you need from God is for Him to straighten out your problems, and what you're giving God is your problems to straighten out.
That's right.
When you're doing prayer requests, we don't consider that as problems. Whatever goes in that box is being given to God. And you can assure too that any offering you give in that box is going to go to God too, because Brother Fred and I don't take a salary. We won't take a salary.
Amen.
I'm not saying it's wrong for a preacher to take a salary, but God gave us the means of supporting ourselves without having to take from what people give right now. We're a startup church. We're starting something new in this area. And we can't do it by him and I taking what people are putting into that box and using on our own bills whenever we're trying to build. And we're going to continue to build. When you stop building for God, you're stagnant. He says that in God's Word. When you get to a stopping point in your relationship with God, that's what you call stagnant. I had a friend of mine in the past, and one of the things that he said one time in a message that he gave, if you're not growing, you're dying.
That's right.
And that stuck with me, because it was like, that is so true. That's one way to look at your relationship with God. If you put a garden out to grow fruit, and you don't focus on them weeds coming up around that garden and the things coming up to destroy that garden, that garden's not going to produce the fruit that it's to produce. So when I say focus on God, and I'm saying tend to the weeds growing up around that fruit or vegetable producing plant, that means if I'm focused on God, I'm also focused on the people that are serving God. But guess what? Sinners will focus on people, well, we're all sinners, people that are not saved. And sometimes people that think they're saved and use their salvation to make them feel better than other people, they're going to focus on what we're doing wrong. If we're out bearing that fruit, or if we're out bearing them vegetables, then whatever we do, they're going to consider it to be wrong. One thing I found out in the work environment that we live in today is you can be the hardest worker there, and people are still going to talk bad about you. And it's usually some of the laziest ones talking bad about you. You know why?
Amen.
It's so much easier to bring you down to their level. If we serve God, are we above anybody else? No, we're not. But we do still want to walk around outside of this building and still want people to see us being Christ-like. Is there anything wrong with walking around and being Christ-like? Does that mean you're holier than thou? No, we're supposed to walk around being Christ-like. In the Bible it says we're supposed to be righteous. Is everything that we do going to be righteous? No. Because then you can't come into these doors if everybody in here is righteous without feeling like you've got to be cleaned up. So that's the point. That's the whole point about being focused on God. Now, something else that we need to do when we're out there in the public's eye, we're going to read verse 16. It says, moreover, when you fast, be not as the hypocrites of a sad countenance, for they disfigure their faces, that they may appear unto men to fast. Verily I say unto you, they have their rewards. But thou, when thou fastest, anoint thine head and wash thy face, that thou appear not unto men to fast, but unto thy Father, which is in secret, and thy Father, which seeth in secret, shall reward thee openly. See, how many times have we seen Christians walk around town sneering at everything around them. I actually had a man tell me to carry around. Some people may do this. I did it for a while when I was not living right. But a man told me, he was one of my my buddies that made moonshine with. I asked him one time, I said, why don't you carry a Bible around on your dash of your car? He said, get me out speeding tickets. So, okay. Anything, try anything that'll work. But the thing is, don't go around sneering at everybody around you out when you're outside of the church doors and make everybody feel smaller than you. Walk around. There ain't no way we allow that in our church. That over there, they going straight to hell. You know that over there that might be going straight to hell, that the people say, well, they're going to hell, it could be their fault. Because they didn't take the time to go over there and tell them about Jesus.
That's right.
Because they didn't see them as someone that wanted their church. And that's sad because there are people out there like that. So when it says right here for that about the fasting, don't go out and just, oh, I'm so hungry because I'm fasting for God. I'm going to be rewarded. And that person comes up beside you and says, you're a good Christian. You're doing such a good thing in your Christianity. That was your reward.
Yep.
Not what you're trying to gain from God. Just like we said about our prayer request box and everything back there. What you put into that is done in secret between you and God. If you're out doing God's work, don't run up into a bar and say, everybody get out of this bar that's drinking because I'm in here doing God's work and I'm going to shut down the bar. That's not God's work. Go with us sometime to a bar and see how we work in the bar. Which go sit down and start talking to people. People that I knew when I was riding with other clubs, they'll come up and talk to them about how my life's changed. And when they see me in that bar, they'll see me drinking a bottle of water and they'll say, hey man, let me buy you a beer. I'm not saying there's anything at all wrong with somebody drinking a beer. There's nothing wrong with somebody drinking a beer if they're not a former alcoholic that shouldn't be drinking beer. Brother Fred's raising his hand. I'm raising my hand. We've got people in here that don't need to do that, but we've got other people in here that can handle it. You want to drink a beer? I'm not saying that's a sin. That's between you and God. But what my friends see in me drinking that water, knowing how I used to drink all that beer and everything, it's so cool about my friends, even if they're still unsaved, they'll make sure I don't run out of water that night. I've had friends let me stand up in their bar when the band takes a break and give a testimony and invite everybody to church right there on stage. Went to the VFW. Band had been drinking in the bar that night, met us there the next morning, showed up, got saved. Kneeling in the parking lot of a bar. What do other churches or other Christians say when they see us walking into a bar? You know what? I don't know because I don't care. They didn't tell me to go in or stay out of it. What I'm saying is, though, are you really being focused on God to go in and shut the bar down and run everybody out and say they're sinning? Or should you go in there? Let's infiltrate. Let's go and sit right where the enemy is and tell these people the good news about what Jesus did for us.
Mm-hmm.
And let them be the judge of it, because I guarantee if I go where they're at, case in point, go where they're at.
Mm-hmm.
Where are you going to meet a person that's not saved? You're going to meet them where they're at. Where do they go? Am I saying that everybody that goes to the bar is not saved? No, I'm not, because we have a really good time when we go there. If you want to know the truth of it, I can even get up in the bar and dance with my wife and have fun there. And not be drinking, my wife don't drink. And let people see that when you become a Christian, you're not that, oh, everything I do and I'm doing it for God, I'm going to go by this bar and talk about everybody going to that bar being a sinner. There's old Brother Will, he's supposed to be a preacher. Going in that old bar. That's what this message says. Don't make what we're doing look like it's such a hard thing to do and expect people to pat us on our back and tell us we're doing a good job. Go out and show people that when you become a Christian, it's not the end of the world. You don't have to stop having a good time, because we have good times, don't we, Brother Fred?
Absolutely.
Brother Greg, we have good times?
We do.
Our good times, go out there at their house on the lake. We go out there and float around. We've done baptisms at the lake. We're going to be doing baptisms here very soon before it starts getting cold. We've got some baptisms that need to be done.
Amen.
And guess what? We're going to have some that need to be done that they don't know it needs to be done yet.
Yeah. Right.
But you know what? The whole time we're doing it, we're going to be focused on God.
Amen.
And we're going to help each other be focused on God.
Yeah.
Now, something else in here on... I'm going to go ahead. I have more in here to read in the scripture. But what I'm going to tell you is Matthew chapter 6. What I was reading from was verse 14 through 24. Please read it for yourself and don't take my word for it. I've had pastors that were Christians and they were saved, but didn't read behind them on things when I was coming up as a young person. My mother had me in church all the time. And the one thing that I got out of not following up on what the pastor was saying is I believed that I could get saved. And then after I'd get out there in the world doing the worldly things, cussing, drinking, and all the other things that God knows about me, I thought that when I come back to church, I'd have to get saved again. And there's a lot of people that think that, but think about this. It's real easy to say that Jesus died one time on the cross for our sins, and everybody focuses on that, saying, okay, I'm saved. Jesus died on the cross for my sins. He only died one time. But think about that every time that if you've been saved in the past, and you know you were saved, and you've been living in the world like you weren't saved, you don't have to get saved to come back, because think about this. For Jesus to be sacrificed again, not just die on the cross, to be sacrificed again so you can be saved again, he has to go through everything that he went through before, the beatings, crown of thorns, flesh ripped from his body, given vinegar when he was thirsty and asked for water, bleeding water because there was no more blood left in him. See, we focus sometimes on Jesus died one time for our sins. Jesus was sacrificed one time for our sins and died on that cross after he had bled out. Final words he said, Brother Fred?
Tetelestai, which means it is finished.
And he did not die until he said it was finished.
Yep.
Didn't have no blood left in his body. So if you were saved, and you've been out in that world, can you get saved again? Can't get saved again if you're saved one time. But that don't mean it's over for you. All you have to do, if you were saved, is ask God for forgiveness. Rededicate your body to the service of God.
Amen.
You know what that tells me? Tells me when I get saved, I don't have to be perfect when I stand up from that altar, when I stand up from that chair, when I stand up from my living room, if you're out there watching. That means I don't have to be perfect when I get saved. That means I focus on God. If I lose focus, Peter lost focus and he was a disciple. Funny thing is, you see all these guys in the Bible, if you read this and understand it, you can see disciples seeing God's work. Still fell short.
Amen.
Paul, one of the authors of a lot of chapters in this Bible, he still fell short. What I like to hear, because I think it's funny, because I said it myself before, is we all know, if you don't know, Paul made a statement in the Bible that said of the sinners, he was the chief sinner. And God still saved him and put him to work doing God's work. By saying he was the chief sinner, he's the worst one of all, is because his main job when Jesus died on the cross was to go out and round up anybody that followed Jesus and kill them. See that they were killed. Command that they be killed. God's still saving. So now when I hear people say, "Oh, Paul ain't got nothing on me," I say, "Oh yeah, you went around killing Christians just for being Christians." We have to understand that our sins can be forgiven. We don't celebrate those sins being the worst sins out there in the world, because we can't do the worst sins out in the world. I read the other day, Brother Fred, in the Bible, where it told me that even if you talk bad about Jesus, even if you down Jesus, even if you told people that follow Jesus is stupid, it told me in my Bible when I read it that you can still be forgiven for that.
That's right.
Okay, now I'm going to go over to, and what it said in the rest of the scripture here is to don't lay up your treasures here on the earth. I'm going to tell you, anything that I have or anything that I own, God provided for me. Because everything that I earned when I wasn't serving God and chased that almighty dollar and said I would never set foot in another church before my life got turned around, I lost every single bit of that. Houses, cars, motorcycles, boats, all of that. Everything that God has blessed me with now is not something I went out and earned on my own. It's something that God has blessed me with for serving Him. See that motorcycle out there that I drove up on? That's not my motorcycle. That's God's motorcycle to use for this ministry.
Amen.
But if I ever stop serving this ministry, God will probably see to it that motorcycle ain't mine no more. Because Brother Fred was with me when I bought that motorcycle and seen all of the things that I was worried about. Well, how am I going to get that motorcycle? I can't have that motorcycle. I had another motorcycle, a very uncomfortable ride, but God said we're going to be doing some traveling, didn't we?
Yes, sir.
So all of us that are out following God are going to be doing that ride. We all got comfortable motorcycles to ride on. If you don't have one that's comfortable to ride on, God's going to see that you're uncomfortable. But we got a healing ministry too within our midst.
Amen.
So if you don't get comfortable or you get sore, you just think you can't make it, we're here to pray for you.
Amen.
All right, I'm going to go straight over here to Philippians chapter 4. I'm just going to let you know when you're focused on God and how you can know when you're not focused on God. It says, "Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, and if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things. Those things which ye have both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do. And the God of peace shall be with you." Paul wrote that to the Philippians. He wrote that in a letter, him and Timothy did, to go to the Philippians. And said, "Whatever you see me do, do. Do it." Now, what kind of responsibility does that put on us to follow that? Because when we see people out in town tell them about God and tell them about what God's doing in our lives, we're basically telling them, "Hey, come on with us, and the things that you see us doing, we want you to be doing with us."
It's fun.
But the thing is, if we go out there and we fail at what we're doing because we lost focus, Jesus reach right back down there, pull us right back up where we need to be.
Amen.
Amen.
If it didn't happen, and it didn't tell me that it happened here in the book, in the Word of God, we wouldn't have talked about it this morning.
Amen.
Okay. If you follow on what I was talking about in Matthew, you're going to run down, if you read the King James Version, you're going to read there where it says, if your eye be single and full of light, your whole body's going to be full of light. And I was sitting there thinking, so if I have one eye, I had one eye for a while, guys. You know what I mean? I wore an eye patch for about 8 months because I had a stroke. And this eye was pointing that way. And I always tell people that was back when I was retired from work because of that. because I work security. You carry a gun. If I'm seeing two people, then it's not good to be trying to, you know what I mean? But, so I was thinking, what does that mean if you have a single eye? So if you're reading this in the King James Version, and you come up to that point where it talks about that the eye being single, it means a healthy eye. Because do I see two different things out of my eyes right now? Do you see two different things out of your eyes right now? Or do both eyes pretty much see the same thing? It's because both eyes focus in together. So if your eye be single, focused on one thing, focused on God, at one with God. Other verses will tell you a healthy eye. Okay, if you're a Christian and you think about what is a healthy eye, that'd be an eye that's focused on God, wouldn't it? Both eyes see the same thing. That's why I tell people about me leaving work. God had told me to go full-time ministry. I said, how am I going to do that? So I kept working. That's growth. It was seeing double. And I said, to me, it feels like a sign of saying, I can't focus on work and focus on God at the same time. I need to focus on God and do God's work.
Amen.
I'm not telling everybody to quit their job. That's not what I'm telling you. But it took me focusing both eyes in, just like it took Paul. If you read about Paul, he focused in on God when he was blind. It took Paul losing his eyesight to be able to focus on what was right and stop killing Christians and start adding Christians to the bunch, start going out looking for them. You read on further down in that scripture and it says, but if your eyes are dark, whole body is dark. So don't look at God for a little bit and then start getting ahead of God thinking that you know what God's doing and start running ahead of God. There's so many times in this building that we've tried to get ahead of God and God's put a stop to it so that we can focus on things that need to be done. Brother Fred said earlier, and I like to have an opportunity to correct Brother Fred. It's kind of like an inside joke between me and Brother Fred. Brother Fred said we started the band. You know, Brother Fred got word and confirmation from God that it was time for him to build a musical ministry, because at the time we didn't even have any of this. We had redback hymnals and everybody sung a cappella. Is that what's coming?
That's right.
With no music at all. And I was the first one that had to get up there and start doing it, and I'm not a singer, but started singing out of there. When he says that, we're not restarting the band, though. We had to be within God's wants for us.
True.
And now we're in position. Because it would get frustrating for us because we didn't have a drummer, we didn't have drums. We didn't have a bass player, we didn't have a bass guitar. We got a bass guitar, and somebody can play the bass guitar. Start setting up the drums, Bob, somebody can play the drums. Thing is, though, what you're going to see when we do get this band up and running, you're going to see people that can't sing, like me, getting up there with people that can sing and trying to do it anyway.
Amen.
Because
Amen.
If you're a Christian,
we don't know why that happened, sorry.
Methodists are about finished with lunch, so it's about time for us to go get ready.
Last call.
But the thing is, you know why I'll get up there and do that with other people that can sing and get up there and throw my old, whatever raggedy kind of voice it is in it? It's because God don't hear me singing bad. He hears me serving Him.
Amen.
Now, how do we focus on serving God if we're not saved? If we decide one day that it's time for me to start serving God, how do I do that? Well, when you decide your life that it's time to start serving God, you're already focusing in on God. You see that target way off. And your heart's not a shotgun pattern jumping out there to serve everything that everybody around them serving or to go out there. You got that one shiny brass bullet. Let's focus on one thing, which is God. So your focus is already there. to get that heart and them eyes and that mind lined up together. It's not a big secret Christian society out there. God makes it real easy for you. We make it real easy for you. You don't have to go and say, God, do I qualify? Do I fill out an application? Say, I joined motorcycle clubs, had to fill out paperwork for that. Paperwork. Yeah, motorcycle club? Yep. I joined the Masons because I was looking for something to join. I had to fill out paperwork. I had to prospect for motorcycle clubs. Brother Fred said he didn't prospect. What I'm saying though is, there's no secret handshake involved. There's no screening process involved with God. You put that needle in your arm on Saturday and you wake up Sunday feeling like your life's going to end if you don't serve God, you don't have to wait for that scar to heal. All you have to do is ask Jesus in your heart and tell God that you believe in Jesus. No secret handshake, there's no screening process, there's no application you have to fill out. I've been turned down by more than one car dealer trying to buy some old piece of junk car just for me to get back and forth to work, spend all that money on beer and at the bar, and get turned down on it, go to the buy here, pay here, and spend more money waiting for on beer to do it than just go depend on my friends to buy me alcohol because they like hanging out with me because they used to do crazy stuff when I was drunk. But you guys that know me here, you can hang out with me because you know I'll do crazy stuff for God now.
Amen.
There is no preparation that you have to do to be ready to serve God. All you have to do is ask. God's not going to say, no, son, you're not ready for it. No, daughter, you're not ready for that. You're not ready for Jesus yet. God's going to say, you're just as important to me as anybody else who's been born on this planet, walked this planet. Because Jesus already died for your sins. Jesus was already crucified for your sins. And believe it or not, as far back as it was, He knew what we were going to be doing. God knows every hair on our head. Am I just spouting this out because this is what I believe? No, this is what God told me, and that's why I believe it. We have been doing things in here to make it easy for people to receive Christ in their heart. And there's a few things that have gone on where we make it easy and we make people understand we're not going to call you out in front of nobody. But there comes a time for everything where sometimes people are ready to show that to other people. They're ready to show that to their loved ones. And they're ready to be accepted within this ministry. Because trust me, if God accepted me, and God accepts you, that don't make me any better than you. That makes me, at that moment, say, hey, even if you've not asked Jesus to be in your life, I still want to hang around you and do stuff because I can show you what Jesus is doing in my life. So let's all bow our heads. Let's all think about the things that God has done for us, even if we're not saved. And if there's anybody out there that would like to be saved and would like to have Jesus in their heart, if someone would like to come up to this altar, if someone would like me to come to where you're at, if someone would like to just do it in private, all you have to do is repeat this after me. Now, if you're wanting this to be done as your testimony, as something that you can stand up in front of everybody and do a testimony for your salvation, nobody look around. If you'll just kind of raise your hand and acknowledge me after I'm done with this prayer, we'll come to you and let you do it in a way where everybody can see it openly that you're ready to serve God. But if you want to do it in private, just repeat these words after me. Lord, I'm a sinner. Lord, I need you in my life to clean me up. Father God, I believe in Jesus, and I believe that He died for my sins. And Lord, I ask that you allow Jesus to come into my heart. Lord, I ask that Jesus be in my heart. And I invite him to come into my heart to make those changes in my life. And Lord, I confess my sins to you and I give them to you. And I pray that you will forgive me. And Lord, I thank you for my salvation. If there be anyone out there that would like to make a testimony of their salvation and would like for us to pray over you for your salvation, just let me know by raising your hand. And we'll do it as an altar call so we can celebrate throughout the day what God's doing in your life. And know that you have chosen that path to be part of the ministry. Have anybody out there that would like to be prayed over for that salvation? Amen. 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 Grab anybody else. Anybody else who would like to receive that salvation? And know the peace that God has given us. See, that'll already be your testimony there. Because before, when I ask you about your salvation, if you want to do it in private, all I ask is that you just go out there and share it with one person. It could be your mom, your brother, email us and let us know. Whatever you have to do to let, so that's called that leap of faith. That's the leap of faith. Do we have any others? We have one who would like to have that salvation prayer done with them. We'll come out there again. You don't have to come up there. Do we have any others? Just raise your hand. Salvation is something, is one of the easiest things you'll ever do in your life. It's just asking you to sit in your heart. And if you've done it in private, God bless you. We actually have a bell up here that we can ring. That salvation is called our victory bell. Not named after Victory Motorcycle, just named after Victory in Christ. Have any others? I don't pressure you in anything that you don't want to do. If anybody has any questions about their salvation, or if anybody would like to come up after the fact, anybody that you've seen in here today can pray over you. But right now we've got someone that we want to pray over right now, and most of them. Will you come out here and sit in this chair with us? Our deacon's up here with us. Anybody else that wants to come up and pray with us? Anybody else? Okay. Brother Greg, do you mind just excuse us in prayer?
because all the angels in heaven are now excited.
We're going to the
flea market.
They've got a good restaurant in there. One of our sisters is in there working. She's been off riding with us and things like that, but she has to work on Sundays now. So we're going to go visit with her too, with fellowship.
And she made a huge pan of banana pudding last night.
And that is awesome.
All right, Brother Fred, would you go ahead and pray for food before we go?
Heavenly Father, Lord, again, we thank you for the people that you send here that need to find you, Father God. Keep us humble and keep us working for you. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to go now in fellowship out in the world. Father, we thank you for the food that you provided for us. Lord, bless it to our bodies and our bodies to your continued service. In Jesus' holy and precious name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Anybody that needs to talk with any of us throughout the week or anything like that, you're more than welcome to.